Thank you, buddy. You know, the Citizens Foundation has obviously done a lot of work on this, and there is a lot of misinformation out there. I would just add a couple little things to what Buddy said here. One is that it's important to note that there is a, as we speak, a $2.8 trillion surplus in the Social Security Fund. $2.8 trillion over and above what they need to operate and sustain this fund. There are also surpluses in the Medicare fund as well. And Buddy referred to the actuaries. These are the people that develop these models, and based on where they think the economy will go and what kind of growth or lack thereof there will be, they try to make projections. How long will that $2.8 trillion, together with the money that's coming in, how long, you know, will that last? That's their job, a very special level of expertise. It is important to remember that they are all projections. And there are different people who will come up with some different projections as to what's going to happen 20 years from now. If we all knew exactly what was going to happen 20 years from now, well, we'd all be billionaires probably, you know. We'd know exactly where to invest our money. So bear in mind, these are projections. The one thing that everybody does agree on, and that is there's some pretty massive surpluses there, that in all probability, you know, it's good, you know, for the next 20 years, and maybe forever, you know, at maybe 75% of the benefits. But, you know, depending on what happens, it could be better, could be maybe worse. The point is, we've got a lot of time. We've got a lot of time to fix this thing, if it needs fixing, and to get it right. There's no emergency here. Okay? So, you know, that's number one. So when people tell you, you know, the house is burning down, we need to fix this thing right away, and we need to turn Social Security over to Wall Street, you gotta ask yourself why. There's no emergency here. What's the big problem? So you gotta ask yourself, why does Wall Street, and why do people who advocate for turning it over to Wall Street want to do that? Well, they're a powerful economic lobby and political interest. For them to get their hands on this fund, why, holy mackerel, the management fees would create even more billionaires than there already are. So, and it's frightening to think what might have happened, you know, to Social Security. You know, had it been being managed by Wall Street over these years. You know, pity the poor people who had their Social Security funds invested in Enron. You know, they'd have nothing. You know, or WorldCom, or any one of a number of companies, including, you know, mining companies right here in the range. They'd end up with nothing, because they bankrupted, you know, all of their funds out. I had a meeting today, earlier this morning, with tradesmen who paid into the multi-employer pension fund all of their life, okay? And these are tradesmen, as you all know. They move from one job to another. You know, one year they're working on Highway 53, you know, in Virginia. Another year they're, you know, working on a new big office building in downtown Minneapolis. Maybe they're working on a pipeline next year. Well, they entered into contracts with these different employers, okay? And under the terms of that, those contracts, they paid in and had taken out of their paycheck every month. money for their pension. Hoping, God willing, you know, I'll live long enough, retire someday, and I'm willing to sacrifice some income now when I'm young so that, you know, in my retirement years, I'll have some income. Well, what happened? What happened? Well, about 1,000 of the companies didn't put their money in. They declared bankruptcy. They went through mergers, acquisitions, all kinds of very clever Wall Street manipulations and machinations. And so now the fund is short of money. So what did they do in the dark of night in the Congress? I voted against it. I pay attention. You know, they put together this so-called pension reform deal, which gives them authority to reduce and or eliminate their pensions. Well, a lot of the mine workers up here had that happen to them. They got their pensions reduced and in some cases eliminated. So when we talk about, you know, securing people's pensions that they've earned, paid in all their life, same way with Social Security, as Buddy pointed out, it's not an entitlement, it's not welfare, it's an earned benefit that people pay for. Thank you. And so they have every right to expect it. And we see time and time and again, you know, the Wall Street bankers got bailed out, not because they were honestly going to work every day and earning those benefits. No, no, on the contrary, they were engaging in all kinds of fancy financial schemes that enrich themselves. They all got bailed out, hundreds of billions of dollars. So what we see happening to these private pension funds is an effort to do away with defined pension benefit programs that people earn. That's what Social Security is. It's a defined benefit plan that people earn. And there is an intensive effort, and it's being very successful. It's doing away with people's pensions. You know, most of us all, we grew up here, and same way with people around the country. I sat at the table with Mom and Dad could have gotten a better job somewhere here or there. But the conversation was, well, you know, in the job you have, Henry, it's got good pension benefits. You know, God willing, we'll live long enough to enjoy it. Mother didn't. Dad did. And so this is important stuff. And I remember the conversations. I remember them real well. You know, you listen up, Richard, Mother would say. You know, your dad's taking a little less right now than he otherwise could, because we want to make sure that we're going to be able to provide for you and the kids and provide for ourselves when retirement comes and not have to rely on you kids. So that's why these defined benefit pension plans are important. That's why Social Security is important. That's why this Medicare is important. And we don't mind taking less now and paying for it so that's there for us later. And now powerful interests are trying to take it all away. That is what is going on here. In the same way, you know, with the insurance plans for Medicare and for private insurance. Think about it. Outside of Medicare, but also in the private insurance part of Medicare, if everybody in this room's got a different policy, everybody, really, can you imagine the administrative nightmare that is? In the medical clinic, I talk to more and more doctors all the time that have had it with it. They went in to become doctors so they could heal people and help with their health, and they spend most of their time in the back room administering, you know, all the procedures, trying to get reimbursement from all these insurance companies. And like I say, everybody has a different plan because it's based on your age, it's based on your health, it's based on your family. It's based on a whole wide variety of conditions and circumstances. So it's an administrative nightmare. And that's why you hear some pretty diverse elements. You see Donald Trump talking about single payer. You see Bernie Sanders talking about single payer. You see Rick Nolan talking about single payer. Why? Well, because nothing is more fundamentally American than single payer. Everybody pays the same, and everybody has the same program. And you're still free. If you want to go do something else, go ahead. But this is the way to do it. That's what the rest of the world does. And that's why some of these countries have a universal national health plans that covers everybody in their country, and they do it for half of what it costs us. And as Buddy pointed out, they have better results. People live longer, they have lower infant mortality rates, and so on and so on. So, you know, this is a big issue. You know, where we're gonna go, and it's based on our values. And as Buddy pointed out, there are people who disagree with this single payer. We want to see it turned over to Wall Street and want to see Medicare turned back over to the insurance companies. There are some of us, myself included, you know, who will fight till our last dying breath to make sure it doesn't happen. So with that in mind, let's open it up to some questions. I promise Jackie, she's got a question here on Medicare. And if you don't mind getting the ball rolling here, Jackie, Buddy,
and
everybody says Jackie doesn't have a sense of humor.
Yes, you know who I am. Of course she does. Virginia, and my problem is with Essentia Healthcare over there. Okay, so, and it involves Medicare. It says things you can do. So I do today to come to you, because you're only one of 10 elected representatives that we send to Congress. And you can only do the Medicare. It's a federal program. There's nobody else that can do it but you. You may be aware of this problem. I don't know. But I'm really miffed with the problem because it happened to me personally. Okay. Hit a rough patch last summer. Go into the hospital. Have surgery. Right hemi. For those that aren't medically involved, it's a colon cancer procedure. And you go through Medicare, you go through this, you go through that.
Try to speak up as loud as you can. I want everybody to hear what you got to say.
So you go in, you get your surgery, they send you up to the med-surg floor, you're there for 8 days, Medicare says, out you go. So you go down the hall, up the elevator, and you go to the skilled nursing home facility. You hit a rough patch in there, they take you down in a gurney in the middle of the night, you go to ER, you're there for hours, they're giving you medication. I never had it before, don't have a prescription for it, and that's a preface to my next problem. They bring you back up into your room in the healthcare unit up there. So now I get a bill from Essential Healthcare that says, I haven't left there in over a month. I go from one place to another. The roof is there. I don't go under a tunnel. I don't go out. I don't come back in. Medicare says, we are not going to pay these charges in the ER because you're considered an outpatient. Now, how did I get out? Yeah. But I'm certainly in your bill collection process, and now all kinds of little threats and so forth, I find out they have no teeth in them, so they can just take what they get from me. Probably be dead before they get it all anyway. So there you are. Can you fix these little loopholes in Medicare? Or has Medicare been so skimmed off because of affordable health care that we are losing, the seniors here, are losing our benefits because you can't afford to pay for all of them?
Good question, Jackie. And there's a twofold answer to it.
And I've got you. You've been corresponding with me. You don't know it, but well, you will remember it now.
All right, thank you. My wife and I just got a bill for some medical services that had already been paid. And it wasn't a lot of money, but if we hadn't, you know, looked into it and checked it out, and just written out a check, they'd have said, you know, thank you. Got a nice little bump on that deal, got paid twice for it. So anytime you have a situation like that, trust me, there are many times when you're not being told what is in keeping with the actual law and reimbursement formulas. And I'm not saying that somebody is necessarily doing something purposefully, but that ends up being the effect of it. I have a staff that works with me, and anytime any of you have an issue like that, first let us look into it. In fact, I'd like to introduce them. I got Jordan Metza here. Jordan, stand up, please. And then I, thank you. Jordan is terrific. I got Tom Whiteside. Tom's over here at Hibbing. Jeff Anderson, who's the director of our office out of Duluth. And, so anytime that you have an issue like that, let us start by making sure that what you're being told is the real deal. And I've got some, and I got Mark Provosky over here too. Mark, yeah. Mark's over by Walker. So let us first take a look at it. And then when they can't fix something, and they do a great job fixing a lot of stuff. Mark and Tom and Jordan.
You're going to take this up to the Medicare business? Because you can't. We can't do anything here. You've got to do it.
Yeah, well, that's what I'm saying. They, along with me, can help you, and a lot of times you have been misinformed, okay? And so these guys are developing some real expertise in this, and many times they can fix it. Now, when they can't fix it, Jackie, that's when they say to me, Rick, this law needs to be changed. Because this ain't right.
Tweak it a little bit. I mean, how can you be an outpatient when you've been in there for over a month?
Well, it sounds ridiculous.
And then if you have to pay, they say you have to pay your own medication. You go to a skilled nursing home. Do you think you can self-medicate yourself?
No. Well, unfortunately,
first of all,
some people
have a prescription.
Do. And they don't
you
know
don't
the right way.
You don't have a prescription for that medication. Yeah. You haven't got the medication.
Yeah.
Secondly, they're not going to let you self-medicate. Yeah. But your Medicare... Yeah, I got it from Essentia, says as an outpatient, they can do that. Are you aware of this, Mr. Nolan?
Well, and that's my point, Jackie, is when you bring this to our attention, that's how I learned what's working and what's not working. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't have any crystal ball. It's when you speak up, you talk to my staff, they look at it and they say, hey, you know, Rick, we tried to fix this. This ain't fixable.
It's not.
So then I've got to, I know what I got to do. You know, I've got to offer an amendment. I've got to get a hold of the agency. I've got to get them to either change the regulations, change the law, whatever it is we have to do. That's how things get fixed. And so that's why I thank you for speaking up. And if you will, just let one of these guys take a look at it first, and
well,
then
Mr. Metza has been good about it, but we're not going anywhere.
Well, then they report to me, and then I got it. Then this becomes my job. And thank you for recognizing that I am one among many.
All we got is 10 representatives from the state of Minnesota.
And I don't mind telling you, University of Vanderbilt and Virginia and the Washington Post other did a study here recently. And forgive me for bragging, but they found that your congressman is one of the 10 most effective members in Washington, D.C.
Absolutely.
Well, it's conceivable after the next reapportionment. You know, I am pretty good at getting things done, and I leave my partisanship at home, and I work with my good Republican friends in Congress, and there are many of them that are more than happy to work with me, and we're able to change some things and get things done whenever they let us.
May I bring up one more issue? This is the drug, the pharmaceuticals. Price gouging.
It's outrageous.
I was put on a drug. I got 2 pills a day for 10 days, 20 pills. I have a very good drug plan. People that don't have one, shall I tell you what they would have paid for those 20 pills?
Please.
$4,000.
Oh, my God.
Well, you bring up another good point, and this gets back to being about being one among many. The Veterans Administration and most of the other countries around the world, they go and they negotiate with these drug companies for the lowest possible price. And we have had votes on this in the Congress. and they have refused to allow the Medicare Administration to go and negotiate these prices. As a result of it, we're paying among the highest prices, higher prices than anybody else in the world. Well, that's just not good business. That's stupid. But once again, Jackie, recognize, you're glad you pointed it out, there are some big beneficiaries of this. They have to be the pharmaceutical companies. And they've got big lobbies. So, well, even, you know, those of us who are pretty darn effective, we can't always win. But we do everything we can, you know, to get a vote. And this is going to have to happen. I mean, I'm telling you, the single payer negotiating these drug prices, this can't go on forever. But you got to remember that politics is kind of a journey. Unlike, you know, the hockey game, you know, there's somebody wins at the end, there's a final score. There's never a final score in this business. And you say to yourself sometimes, what have I learned along the way in life? Well, you know, there were powerful interests that were against Social Security to begin with. They were against Medicare to begin with. They're against, you know, allowing the negotiation of these prices. They're against single payer. And they don't go away. You know, they're still fighting to roll back progress that's been made. And in time, and then one last thing, and then I'll take this question over here. You got to be mindful of some certain things. And one of the things I'm very mindful of is that in our grandparents' time, think about it, the life expectancy in this country was 47 years of age.
Yeah, I'll be there
47.
Shortly.
Today it's darn near 80.
Okay.
Well, how did that happen? Well, one of the things, Social Security provided people some income in their retirement years. Medicare provided people with some medical care in their retirement years that they couldn't otherwise afford. And I could go on and on, list you a number of things. But great progress was made in cleaner air, cleaner water, better medical research, and a whole wide range of things happened, and it doubled life expectancy. Holy mackerel! Homo sapiens been on Mother Earth for a long time, but in one generation to double the life expectancy may be one of the greatest accomplishments in humankind. But there are still powerful forces out there that want to roll it all back, and we can't let them do it. I said this gentleman here first, and then you.
You hit a sore spot when you mentioned the Veterans Administration. I fell on some hard times here about 5 years ago. Went to see about getting some help. When they asked me what they could do for me, I said, well, I would like to get a little help here. He said, how much money do you make? First words out of his mouth. And what he said was that you're a little bit above poverty level. We can't do a thing for you.
Well,
now, that's a hell of a way to treat a veteran.
Yeah, that is just wrong.
Well, it's going on. It's been going on for at least 5 years now that I know of.
Well, I'd like to look into that on your behalf, too. And we're trying to fix this. And, you know, my approach to this whole thing is twofold. One, if you are willing to step up and serve and protect us, by God, we've got a profound moral obligation to be there to support you when you need our help. That's number one. And number two, if the Veterans Administration can't do it, and that's what this free choice was supposed to be all about, then you should be able to go to a doctor in your own community,
absolutely,
and that should be paid for. That,
absolutely.
Cut and dry. That's the way it's got to be.
Payment to certain doctors, certain hospitals, certain clinics. You can't go where you want to go. You got to go where they tell you to go.
Yeah.
And that's the lower class doctors, the lower clinics. And, you
know, and that's wrong. You should be able to have
go
that
to
choice.
Any doctor, any clinic you want to go to.
Absolutely. You should have your choice.
Right.
I promise the gentleman in the back here.
My question's a little different than specific.
You'll have to speak up a little louder.
My question's a little different than the specific examples that you folks have cited, but it pertains to everything that you've talked about here, and it has to do with this Medicare premiums for 2016. Okay, Now, you talked about increase in healthcare costs, you talked about maybe threats to the program, and if a retiree stays eligible for this now, if you postpone your Social Security, you can get an 8% increase each year beyond your, the age that you're eligible for your full benefit.
Yeah, if you're still working.
No, you don't have to be working.
No?
So from 60.
You guys correct me if I'm wrong on this, but I don't believe you still have to.
I think you do. You have to be adding your income and your credits and your contributions.
So there are people out there, now this might be a hypothetical, but I think it's an actual experience, that they might look at that and say 8%, that's probably better than what I can get without any high risk of going into the stock market or just throwing it into a bank.
Well, let me correct myself. You are right without having to work. There is a higher benefit if you wait.
If you're under that threshold and you qualify, then you can look at that and say, you know, I can make 8%. I says, I can live maybe a little bit more modestly.
Well,
and because the costs will go up and there are threats to the program or Social Security possibly could be reduced, you might look at that and say, well, I'm at age 70 and I have to tap into that. You're going to have a 32 or 33% increase in your Social Security payment monthly. You can take that money and say, well, no, I can use that because your health might be good, it might be not, but it's probably going to be poor as you age, and you can use that to supplement yourself and you go on.
Yeah, if you
But my question then becomes, if you did that and you're under the threshold, then your Medicare premium increased for 2016. Yet if you were on Social Security and you're under that threshold, it didn't. You still might pay that $104.80, which is what I believe you paid in 2015. But this year, if you're under that threshold, it's $121.89. I don't remember the exact figures, but it's somewhere around there. I don't understand how they came about coming to that conclusion.
Well,
two
things.
It seems they're penalized for trying to not take money from the system, defer it for a later part, just so you don't have to live off of somebody else.
Sure.
You know, you might have a little bit of pride when you're going and say, I just still support myself if I can, even if I got to live a little more meagerly.
Well, a couple of things. One is...
How did they come about doing that?
Yeah, let me try to answer. Two things. One, when you reach that retirement age, it's a little bit different for everybody. It might be 62 and 8 months or 12, whatever it is. They can calculate exactly for you what your benefit will be at age 65 in 10 months.
Yes.
And it will be greater.
Yes.
Now, if you continue to work during that period of time, it will be even greater.
Or not.
No, if you continue to work, it will be even greater than that number.
Well, I see what you're saying.
You're adding more credits and more to it.
But if you don't continue to work, it'll be greater also.
Yes, and they can tell you exactly what that amount will be.
Yeah.
Okay, so one of the things you have to do, and there are financial models and where you can do it, and... in general, I think you have to live to be at least 78 in order to come out ahead on that deal. So, depending, you want to look at your health and say, you know, am I going to make it to 78? And if you think you are, why, you're better off to wait. If you're sitting there with lung cancer or you're just in bad health, well, then you better take it right now.
Okay. But why do your premiums go up?
Well, you know, I'm not sure about that because at one level, if you're not taking Social Security between that 62, 63, and 65, 66, you're not on Medicare.
I'm talking about when you are eligible for Medicare.
Okay, yeah, Buddy's got an answer here. Let's try.
The question about why is the Medicare premium going up? So just try to do this real quick. So when I did the basics, it comes from, it's paid from a few different sources, right? And that Medicare premium, there is actually a formula that it's something like 25% of the total Medicare Part B expenses. So as the cost of medical care goes up, that can cause that Medicare premium to go up. The real answer to that is what we talked about before, of holding down the cost and growth of medical expenses in general, and with Medicare. If that were to be done, that would hold down increases in the Medicare Part B premium.
But he had a different question. He's wondering why it goes up for the one who's not on Social Security, and it doesn't go up for the one on Social Security.
You're on Medicare, and you could have even filed for Social Security or not filed for it. But if you're not collecting Social Security payments, you got a premium increase. If you are collecting Social Security,
If you're already on Medicare, then your premium is locked in for most people. If you're new to it, or a couple of other categories, then you get hit with the increase.
Well, I know that.
Right.
Why? That's the question. How is that figured out? I don't understand why a person that's trying to live off of less.
What was the original rationale for Congress in doing it that way? I don't know. It'd be a good question. And Congress could change it.
You know, we'll look into it. It's a good question. Thanks for asking that. Yeah. Well, the short answer is they probably wanted you to pay more.
They probably thought anybody that isn't collecting probably has the affluence, so they can pay a little bit more. But there are those people out there that don't have that affluence. They just live a little different lifestyle. They're under the threshold.
Sure. Just well, thank you. That's a good question. I'll look into it. This gentleman here.
Yes, sir. The question I have is in the 60s, mid-60s, I worked in the mines. Then I went in the military. Came out of the military, worked in the mines again, got laid off in 82. During that whole time, I was paying into Social Security. Had all my quarters paid up as far as I could go. Decided at 37 years old to go into law enforcement. Worked 30 years there and retired. During the time that I worked, I became eligible for Social Security, which I could take my Social Security benefit while I was still working. Now, being that I retired under para, police and fire, and I don't know if there's any others in here or not, Social Security tells me, and I know you made a statement about big interest wants to take this away from you. Government wants to take it away from me. I can't get my Social Security anymore. All I can do is get my police and fire. Well, I'm sorry. Why?
How old are you?
Pardon me?
I don't mean to pry, but...
Well, it's okay. I'll be 67 in April.
Okay.
Because it works that way. I have a government pension, and we didn't even pay into Social Security because we're not getting anything. You have a government pension, and that's supposed to help you out. If you have done other things, where if you have worked for a government agency of some kind, and you paid into Social Security at that time, but if you're not paying into Social Security of any kind,
well, I paid into the FICA part for the last 30 years.
I know, but you paid in. A friend of mine had a husband who not only paid into railroad retirement,
yep,
but paid into Social Security, and when he died, his wife didn't get anything from Social Security.
That's right.
Because you can't double dip.
Well, that's garbage. That's garbage. That's your money, like they said right there. That is your money that you put in at one time.
I didn't make the law.
No, I know you did. That's what has to change. Our government has taken that away.
From what I've heard, you know, you're both right. She's saying she didn't pay into it. So therefore, you paid into it.
I paid into both.
So you earned it. You earned it. You should be getting it. It's that simple.
That's why we didn't pay into it, because we weren't going to get it. So we didn't pay in.
So they didn't pay in. So you earned it. She's saying, we don't get it because we didn't earn it. We didn't pay into it. So and I don't know if this is a factor how good your pension is or not, but if you continue to work and you're, and I don't have the formula right here at, on the tip of my tongue, but at some point, for every extra $2 you make, there's a dollar of your Social Security that is reduced, and that you know adds to the Social Security that you will receive at a later date, so you don't lose that if you live long enough. That's always the big question in all this, but I don't know if that's a factor or not, but. I agree with the fundamental of what you're saying. You earned it, you should get it.
I mean,
I personally don't think Social Security income should be taxed, period. You know, this is a time in your life when you're taking you know, your income has been dramatically reduced. This is when we have some of our biggest health problems. Some of this bit about the golden years can be overrated. I don't know about you, but I'm grateful for my health, but I did wake up one night here about a month ago, and I didn't remember stubbing my big toe, and I could hardly walk with the damn thing. I went to the doctor, and he said, "You got gout." I said, "Oh, God." I said, "What do I do with that?" He says, "Don't drink beer." "Really?" that was more painful than the toe, so... that's the least of the problems we have to deal with. But thanks. I'll look at your particular case, see if I can learn something from that too that we can help fix it. And thank you for your service.
Thank you.
I have a Social Security question. Huh? I have a Social Security question. I worked 40 years for the telephone company and retired. And at 62, I took my pension. And since that, I've worked 10 years and paid into Social Security, and my Social Security has not changed $1. And I called them and asked them about it. They said, "We check it every October and it'll be adjusted." Well, it's been 10 years and there's been no adjustment.
Well, for sure, talk to Jordan or Tom here, because that's not right. You got a big check coming.
I mean,
no, you do. You got a big check coming. Yeah.
Good.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
I'm just going to know in regard to what that young man down there said, I do not get the Social Security pension. But when I was 65 and I had to apply for Medicare, I had to do it under my husband's Social Security number. So I've been on Medicare for almost 10 years now. And this January, my Medicare raised from 104.90, which everybody $120 and some cents. So I called Social Security, and I waited on the phone for 35 minutes to talk to somebody. And she said to me, "Hey, well, the Medicare premiums are being raised this year, so yours is being raised now, but everybody else will be raised eventually. Is that true?"
Well, we did, and the omnibus thing, they expected, related to the cost, a 20% increase. The Part B premiums, and we passed an appropriation that was supposed to keep that from happening. Now that was just, you know, a few weeks back here. So if it's not happening, we need to know that. So thank you. I'll look into it.
Yes, and I don't think it's fair. They don't even have to take the time to bother to send you a check or put it through the bank or whatever.
Yeah.
But I'm the one that gets.
Well, I can tell you, you know, please let us know about these things. I'll tell you one quick story. We had a fellow that kept running into stone walls, and he gave up on it quite some years ago with regard to Social Security. And he had heard that Congressman Nolan and his staff were pretty good at, you know, looking into this stuff and seeing to it that these agencies did the right thing by him. And so we went to work on his case, and we found out that Social Security Administration owed him almost $57,000, $60,000. And we were able to get that for him. In your case, you should be getting an adjustment on a regular basis for that additional earned income and contribution. So when you run into these problems, let us know, because sometimes it's just the process and human error. You know, there's a legion of people, and you know, maybe they were hung over from the night before when they processed your claim, you know. Maybe they were self-medicating on something the day they were doing your data. I mean, I don't know, but you know, the people make mistakes. It's just that simple. And sometimes it's harder than heck to get correction. Like she said, after a half an hour, you know, you want to hang up the phone. How long do I have to wait here? But we have ways to get through a little quicker than the average citizen, and we like to do that. So let us know.
While waiting on the phone, I got a year ago, and they had the stations were told, and they said I could call and get that.
I guess you got to interrupt again.
45 minutes.
I tried to call Comcast Communications, and I threatened to put in a bill to, by law, take them from, or require them to take communications off their name. Just because, I mean, you can wait for hours trying to get a hold of someone.
Robert Bassett, retiree from U.S. Steel. On that 121 and 10490. I handle my mother-in-law's papers. She's in a nursing home. The law states that those people that are not collecting Social Security benefits will not be subjected to the increase. That's what it is. It went up for everyone, but those people that are not collecting Social Security benefits are not subject to the increase on the Medicare Part B premium. That takes care of that. No.
Wait a second. Jordan.
Yeah.
Oh, there's Jordan. Tom was talking to him. State that again so that young man can hear that.
The papers that I got from my mother-in-law about the Social Security premiums stated that those people that are not collecting Social Security benefits will not have their premiums raised. So what they did was they did an exemption for those people that are collecting Social Security benefits. They did increase their Medicare premium. That's what the paperwork said.
Well,
because she's on PRA annuity, so she's not collecting Social Security, so her premium went up to 121 some change, whatever.
Yeah, she's not collecting Social Security, so her premium went up.
Right, but if you're collecting Social Security, it said in the letter that your premium would stay at 104.
Yeah, that's what we
yeah.
said.
That's what
okay.
the letter
we said.
Said
that.
Yep.
That's what the letter said.
Okay.
So the main thing you missed here. By the way, I was a Republican for 30 years, my first 30 years. And to give credit to the fascists, they're fascist. I quit voting for them because the Republican Party died in 1980. Whether it's Jews and Muslims, or whether it's going against poor people or minorities, the patterns of fascism are clearly there. If you go back, study history, you'll know Nazi Germany. The big thing you missed was the reason why this program is under threat. And it is a dire thing. It's not like you're saying there's not a house on fire. Here's the thing. Perot was right. When you move good paying jobs out, the slave labor overseas, you're gonna have to put nets at the first floor of the building where they make the Apple phones.